Now let's discuss the first major internet worm, also called the Morse worm, after its creator Robert Morris. Here's how the worm worked. When the worm runs on a system, it looks for other systems on the internet that it can spread to. For example, these systems have some security vulnerabilities that the worm can exploit. And then, by exploiting these vulnerabilities, the worm can infect these systems. In other words, it can lower itself to these systems, and that's how it spread. Once the worm got on the system, it also employed a number of tricks in order to keep itself from detectable. According to its creator, the internet worm was meant as part of an experiment to measure the size of the internet, for example, by measuring how many computers are connected together. However, there was a programming error in the code. That is, the worm would infect a computer regardless whether the computer had been infected or not already, 1 out of 7 times. This proved to be too aggressive, and as a result, many computers get infected repeatedly. That is, on these computers, there are many instances of the same worm running, resulting in resource exhaustion. And that's really how the internet worm was discovered, because the sysadmins find out that their servers were overloaded. As a response, many sysadmins disconnect their servers from the internet in order to stop the spread of the internet worm. But since many servers were disconnected, the internet was disrupted as well. When the internet worm identified the next target to infect, it looked for several security flaws that it knew how to exploit. These include systems with guessable passwords, systems running the Finger-D program that had a buffer overflow vulnerability, systems running the sendmail program that has a trapdoor, which means that by supplying some special input commands, one can gain access to these systems. When these security flaws were exploited, the internet worm can gain access to a target system. It then will load a small piece of code called the bootstrap loader onto the target machine, and this loader would then fetch the rest of the worm code. It even used password-based authentication to make sure that only the bootstrap loader of the worm can load the rest of the code of the worm. The internet worm also employed a number of tricks to hide itself. For example, the worm code is loaded into the memory, it is encrypted and decrypted when necessary, and the original file is removed from the hard drive so that the user will not be able to see the worm program. The worm even periodically changed its process name and process ID so that even when a sysadmin looks at what programs are running on the server, he cannot easily discover the internet worm. The internet worm resulted in major disruption to the internet because many servers were infected and had to be disconnected from the internet. So what lessons did we learn? The first lesson we learned was that we need to perform security scanning and patching. The internet worm was able to infect so many servers because these servers had security flaws. Further, most of these flaws were not only well known, but also had security patches or fixes available. Therefore, if we scan and patch computers on the internet that have security flaws, then we can reduce the chances that they will be infected by malware. The second lesson is that we need to have a fast and coordinated response to a major security incident such as the internet worm. And because of the internet worm, the US government established the Computer Emergency Response Team, or CERT for short. Nowadays, CERT is usually responsible for issuing alerts about security flaws and recommendations about patches.